to build a united, non-racial, non-sexist, democratic, and prosperous South Africa for all. Based on the consensus reached, the National Working Committee will take its detailed perspectives on forming a government in South Africa to the National Executive Committee, which is scheduled to take place tomorrow. On the matter of the appointment of premiers in various provinces, the ANC, in line with the electoral rules on Monday, the 3rd of June, 2024, which is just a day after the announcement of results, did convene extended sessions of its provincial executive committees to nominate candidates for premiers in the provinces where the ANC has gained a majority or is likely to lead a coalition government. The extended PECs that included representatives from its alliance partners were overseen by presiding officers from the ANC Electoral Committee that is led by Comrade Halima Motlante. Each PC was required to nominate three premier candidates, of which two candidates are women. All candidates will be interviewed in the coming days by ANC national officials. The final ANC premiers and premier candidates will be unveiled early next week. Provincial legislatures are due to sit on the 17th and the 18th of June to elect the presiding officers in the name of the Speaker of a Legislature, the Deputy Speaker of a Legislature, and the Premier of that particular province. The ANC welcomes a robust debate in society amongst its members. On the way forward, following the outcomes of the 2024 general election, we have noted documents purporting to be official documents of the ANC being distributed on digital platforms. We once again reiterate that any official communication by the ANC will be published on our official communication platforms and call on all persons that are engaged in some form of misinformation or disinformation to desist from doing so, from wherever they come. The current situation has created some uncertainties and risks, but also opportunities to move the country forward, more determined to tackle the problems its people face, more determined to unite and face the future together as South Africans. The ANC is committed to ensure that we unite the people of South Africa to move our country forward and form a government that reflects the message from the electorate, which is the message that says we must all work together. Many other democracies who face similar challenges of forming government often take months of uncertainty to reach a conclusion. The ANC remains committed to ensure that we build a national consensus to avoid any uncertainty that can lead to instability. And we aim to do that with as much expedition as possible. The National Executive Committee of the ANC will come with a clear determination of the way forward, because the National Executive Committee is the final arbiter on this particular matter internally within the African National Congress. The NEC will further engage the Alliance, civil society, and all South Africans on our view about the immediate steps as well as the future. We will make further announcements about the NEC meeting and opportunities for the media to engage in due course by way of media advisories. As we end, we continue with our campaign slogan, "Let us do more together." I end the ladies and gentlemen, members of the media, and I'm happy to take questions.
Rachel Savage from The Guardian. Will the MWC be recommending one particular way forward, so one set of coalition negotiations with one, you know, constellation of parties or a single party, or will multiple options be going to the NEC? Can you set out what these options are, please?
Thank you very much. Shall we proceed to... I am trying to look for any other hand. I always start on my left, as is custom.
Hi, I'm Nellie Payton from Reuters. You said that the results indicate that South Africans want all parties to work together. Does that mean that the ANC would be trying to work with as many parties as possible?
Christian Duplessis from Nathan Killington. My question is, you said that there were three options that was discussed. What is those three options? And then on the second issue, Minister Zizi Kodwa was arrested and appeared in court today. Will the ANC's step-aside rule now be implemented? And what is the ANC's comment on this matter? Thank you.
Hello, Dr. Bakke from Agence France Presse. You mentioned that there's been a meeting with the...
Sorry, if you could just reiterate who you...
Dr. Bakke from Agence France Presse, AFP. You mentioned meetings with the IFP, the EFF, the DA, the NFP, and the PA. Have any of these parties expressed willingness to join the national a government?
Thank you very much. If I may, I can take the fourth.
Sorry.
I can take the fourth question over there.
Thank you. Sam Tabatam, who's 24. Mine is to add to the question about Zizi Kodwa, Minister Zizi Kodwa. What is that going to do? What is his appearing in court? What kind of impact will he have on the lists in Parliament? And also, there's a conundrum that you're facing with the structures and your veterans and civilians. They are speaking about it in public, the concerns with partnering with the team.
Yes, sir, you see?
We've seen your veterans comment in public around their concerns with partnering with the DA, and they're citing the past that the DA has. Does the ANC have a plan to deal with that? Was it discussed in the NWC as well? Thank you.
May I just start with the last question from News 24? The ANC has got an internal democracy process. Anyone that speaks outside of that internal democratic process, knows that they ought to be engaging with both leaders and members of the ANC. Even at this moment in history, we are not going to shake away from that responsibility to hold the line, because in a may just indicate that the National Working Committee meeting was very cohesive, robust, engaging, and we urge anyone who has views to engage both the National Executive Committee and the National Working Committee. I will not be commenting on individual comments by those that are associated with the African National Congress. But that is the perspective and that is the culture in the African National Congress. We don't go off script and outside of the line of the ANC. And so we urge people to do so, even as there is a lot of anxiety from our members about the various permutations that are involved in establishing what type of a coalition setup we are going to consider, where we need to set up coalitions. And remember, we don't have to set up coalitions everywhere. We have achieved outright majority in a number of provinces, but where we need to do so, including nationally, that is what we are doing. Siyamthanda, I hope that responds to your question. The question about whether the EFF and the Patriotic Alliance would be willing to form part of the Government of National Unity. It is our understanding that the fact that those parties have reached out and we have also reached out to them is indicative of the willingness to talk about building national unity in South Africa. And you can't build national unity at this point in time because the ANC has not secured an outright majority. Even when the ANC secured an outright majority in the past, we have always invited various parties into government. That includes Patricia de Lille. I can count others, quite a number of those. In Parliament, we had Nkululeko Shembe as the chairperson of the Public Accounts Standing Committee. So this is not new to the ANC, but the people of South Africa are asking for us to work closer together in the interest of fostering unity. On the matter of Zizi Kodwa, all I can say is that we've noted that, and the step-aside policy of the ANC will kick in, or shall I say the constitution of the ANC will kick in, because we respect the rule of law, and I suppose there's really no question about that. And then, the thing about whether as many parties as possible and all of that, I think the most important thing is to ensure that when the options that have been set out, such as a government of national unity, such as a minority government, are explored by the National Executive Committee tomorrow, that the best option will be looked at. At this point in time, the conversation is looking at the government of national unity, because this is what the people of South Africa have said to us, that put together a multi-party arrangement that works for the benefit of South Africa. As to which parties will finally form part of that is a function of ongoing negotiations. I hope I have covered that aspect. I can indicate that the ANC has reached out to everyone, literally everyone, and is continuing to reach out to everyone in a very short space of time, because as we say in our statement, we don't want to have an information vacuum and a situation where, as we've seen it elsewhere in other democracies, where you have a very long wait before there's certainty about how government is being constituted in circumstances such as the ones that we're having. So you can applaud us for, at least you can applaud us for the fact that we've immediately initiated conversations with not just like-minded parties. At this point, we're not dealing with that notion, we're engaging everyone. Of course, we're engaging everyone on the basis of our values, in our principles and our policy positions. And when the National Executive Committee meets tomorrow, it will consider all of those fundamentals that we need to take into account in deciding on who forms part of that government of national unity. I'm not in a position to speculate what the final outcome or final decision of the National Executive Committee is going to be. I'm happy to take any further questions. Sandy, where are you? Okay. That's not Sandy, where?
Good afternoon. My name is Bulo Gumloto from ENCA. I just want to understand whether during the negotiations with all those parties that you have spoken to, you have had disagreements that you felt were deal breakers, and also whether, as you say, you said you reached out to MK Party. Who specifically did you reach out? I'm just thinking here if you went through perhaps the officials Did you try to go through Mr. Jacob Zuma, who is the party president, who also happened to be a member of your party, the ANC, just saying if you really were serious to hear from them, did you consider that? And perhaps lastly, these negotiations, are they, because you have lost KZN and Gauteng, as you negotiate, are you considering options of, say, at the national level, you will go with Party A and you consider going with Party B at the provincial level?
Sam Kelamasaka from the SAPC. First question to the spokesperson of the ANC is, what is the basis of briefing the media today when the decisions you take, you don't take decisions in the MWC, you rather make recommendations that can be rectified by the ANC's NEC? What is the basis of coming with recommendations that have not yet been endorsed by your highest making decision body or decision structure between conferences? Then secondly, where is the Secretary General of the ANC? Isn't he the one who should be briefing on these particular pertinent issues with regards to the trajectory of the country, noting that he is effectively the CEO of the governing party? And then, on the issues of negotiations, what were some of the conditions placed before you by the EFF, the PA, the DA, the NFP, and the IFP? Then lastly, on KwaZulu-Natal, is there already a compact deal that has been sealed between all of the opposition parties in that province, the ANC, the DA, the EFF, and also the IFP, which will replace Mr. Thami Ntuli as the premier of that particular province, with the ANC taking two MECs and the speaker position within that province of KwaZulu-Natal? And lastly, is Jacob Zuma politicking you? Thank you.
I missed the last question. Is Mr. Jacob Zuma...
Is Mr. Jacob Zuma blue-ticking your officials on the virtue that he has said if he give the AD his votes of the MK party, he wants the president of the country, Cyril Ramaphosa, gone as in yesterday? Thank you.
May I tackle these questions before Mwandi? I want to start off with, where is the SG, should he not be doing the briefing? It is standard, you are going to get accustomed to it, Samkelo. The spokesperson of the ANC does the briefings that are supposed to be done by the spokesperson of the ANC in accordance with the internal communications protocol. So I invite you to familiarize yourself with that. The SG is overseeing negotiations that are taking place. But even if he was not, it is the responsibility of the national spokesperson to communicate decisions of constitutional structures such as the National Working Committee. And why briefing the media from the NWC? I did explain this as I was reading out the statement, that we want to take our members along on this journey so that there is no vacuum in terms of communication. Compact deal in KZN, I wouldn't be that familiar with that compact deal. We did have the participation of the KZN leadership at our National Working Committee meeting. They have guidance from the national office, from national officials, from the National Working Committee. They have also taken us into confidence about some of the initial conversations that are taking place in KwaZulu-Natal, which demonstrate alignment between the national thinking as well as that of the province. They have been given a further mandate to proceed with the negotiations that are taking place. I wouldn't be able to expand beyond that, but that is the mandate, together with the delegation of provincial office bearers in Gauteng. The same thing happened. They were part of the National Working Committee, so you could say it was an extended National Working Committee. Is Zuma blue-ticking the ANC? I'm not able to put myself in the head of Mr. Zuma. but we can indicate that we have made approaches to the NK party for the record, for colleagues in the media to note that. When we do get responded to, or if we do get responded to, we would then do exactly as we've done with other parties. I am not aware of conditions that have been put before the ANC. The talks that we've been having have been exploratory, number one. Secondly, there hasn't been a sense of arrogance from the parties that we've met, in the same way that the ANC has been humble enough. If you went through the statement that we issued 2 days or 3 days ago, that's a spirit that generally is pervasive. And if there are particular conditions that don't align with the values and the principles of the African National Congress, we would deal with those as they come. And I'm sure the NEC will be looking very closely with a hawk's eye on those. I want to proceed to the sign the work.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Mazing, and good afternoon to you and the colleagues. In my mind, first of all, surely the NEC should be taking stock as an organization internally of what other people want and demand. As an organization itself, about how they found itself their way going into the 2019 election, that 2% of the support, and 2 elections later, it has turned by more than 20 percentage points to 40% this time around. Therefore, I want to ask if the NEC will it be pinning its tank of 20 percentage points on who was the head during the period in question, which is the president of the ANC, Mr. Cyril Ramaphosa, or will the ANC this time around once again trigger the collective responsibility part, which would require the organization of either the NGC or a special conference where the whole of the ANC falls by its sword? That's number one. Number two, as it relates to President Zuma of the NK party, who's also, at least according to him, a disciplined member of the ANC, why does the ANC not just command its disciplined member in the form of President Zuma to bring the numbers and then the ANC governs? And then let me rest there for now, thank you.
Hi, John, and we go on to New York Times. I have two questions. One on the timeline. Does the ANC have a timeline for when you all would both like to make a decision on what you all want to do, and also a timeline for when you all might actually come to an agreement with what your partners are? And the second, just on the government of national unity, but by definition, as the ANC sees it, does that have to include all parties in Parliament, or do you all see it as something only the parties who wish to be involved?
I'm happy to end the briefing with responses. So I would suggest that we take all hands. Yes. Please go ahead, my brother.
My name is Salam Kridir from Salami. Just on clarification, your advances to the MK, were they ignored completely or they were responded with no interest?
The option of being in opposition, is that out of the question for the ANC, or will the ANC also discuss the issue of going the other way? Thank you.
Considering the fact that we have already had some of the leaders of the ANC, those in the NEC and those who are veterans expressing their preferences, would you concede that perhaps this particular juncture we find ourselves in as the country, and you particularly as the party, perhaps is an acid test for your renewal project, when some, including your alliance partners, are also expressing disquiet at the possibility of you going into a coalition with the DA? But let's go to provinces. In Mpumalanga, my understanding is that four names instead of three as per the guidelines for premier candidates were nominated, and that is because the name of the incumbent Premier Filimzwe Tsipane had to be included all because she is the incumbent. But by the look of things, the numbers did not go in her favor. How are you going to deal with that? Lastly, there's one of your MPs, Mr. Boemo Mabulo, who has written a letter of demand to the ANC in Limpopo demanding that he be reinstated, go to the National Assembly or the NCOP. Failure to do so by the end of today, he threatens to interdict the swearing in of the ANC members of parliament who will be representing the populace once.
A follow-up question, if I may. So this government of national unity, does the ANC envisage ministries being divvied up on proportional lines as per the vote of the parties in the government of national unity? And does it also envisage all parties in parliament or those above a certain threshold taking part in this government of national unity if they want to and if the ANC agrees? And finally, the DA, you know, has been very vocal about the EFF and the MK, and the EFF, you know, and MK, you know, have also been vocal about the DA. Have the DA and the EFF expressed willingness to work in a government of national unity together?
And those were the last ones.
Also, just a follow-up question. Can you elaborate on the possible coalition permutations that has been discussed? And just secondly, there has been talks on social media about the markets and whether the markets should be taken into account with coalitions. Is that a factor that will be taken into account? Thank you.
Whether markets have to be taken into account? Okay.
Yes, this morning was Mawande again from Sunnyway. I thought I was going to come back, but it's fine if it's fine now. An important question that I wanted to ask, is the ANC in this particular process still guided by the National Democratic Revolution, an NDR thereof which has a national question, which says the motive forces of the mass democratic movement are that it seeks to liberate black people first and Africans in particular. Is the ANC in this process still guided by those principles of the NDR, particularly the national question that I just recited, or is it now guided by an interest to just remain in power, even if it compromises the principles of the National Democratic Revolution? Thank you very much.
I'm Vela Nyotito from Daily Maverick. Minister Sizikodwa has resigned. Could you also just also add a comment on that one?
Okay, thank you very much. Of these several questions, let me deal with the one about whether the ANC is still guided by the principles of wanting to achieve a national democratic society through the theory of national democratic revolution. Absolutely. Which ties up with the question by News 24 around whether we would consider an option of being in the opposition benches. I can't speculate on all of those things, but I can tell you that the ANC would go as far as that in order to safeguard its historical mission, its values, and its principles. So those are some of the options that are on the table. I know some of you colleagues are expecting us to give you finality, and questions to my left were really speaking around some kind of definitiveness. We're not going to be able to do that until we go to the National Executive Committee. We're calling this briefing in order to update you, and more importantly, to convey the message to the people of South Africa, to our members and supporters, utilizing the instrument of the fourth estate. But indeed, our commitment to a national democratic society cannot be changed on the basis of the fact that we have not achieved an outright majority. In the conversations about who we're going to finally go into a coalition with, those will be the key principles that we consider, the kind of policies and a set of policies that those that will go into a government of national unity with will be considered. So I wanted to just say that, to respond to the two questions similarly. That was the question from Sunday World. Markets being taken into account in making the decisions that we have to make. Markets as well as, more importantly, the people of South Africa. What their expectations are, what they are deserving of, not as passive participants, but as active participants, because they've shown us, they've shown everyone that democracy is well and alive in this country. The electorate has spoken. So it cannot be that our responses are on the basis of what the markets are likely to say. Surely we have got to consider a number of interest groups, and we've got to consider the state of our economy, but more importantly, what comes first are the expectations of the people of South Africa. Whether there is a willingness to discuss ministers, the constitution of the cabinet, if I may paraphrase the question, I'm certain that at the right time that will be considered, because if you are building a government of national unity, remember we're not new to constituting a government of national unity as the ANC. We did that in 1994. So we do have the benefit of experience more than anybody else. And I'm sure that that is those will be one of the considerations. Moloko, ENCA, the renewal project. One of the real tests of the ANC having the decline that we experienced in the election has been the fact that the renewal project is at work. You may not see it that way. We have lost some members. We have expelled some. We have suspended some, precisely because the renewal project is not spin. It's hard at work. And we are likely to, you know, accelerate even more, because rather fewer than having people that may blemish the integrity of the African National Congress. So I would say to you that the renewal project is steaming ahead. Many lessons are there, and we need to continue with the work of renewing and cleansing the African National Congress in order to contribute to the renewal of society. It's not a matter of renewing the ANC for its sake, but it's a matter of renewing the ANC in order to contribute to the renewal of society. We're absolutely convicted about that. If you look at the past recent history, the past 12 months or thereabout, we expelled a former Secretary General. We suspended a former president. If that's not renewal, I don't know what renewal is. That forms part of that. When somebody has been convicted in a court of law, we have asked for them to step aside. Others have stepped aside voluntarily. That's part of the renewal project. It's not only just that. A lot of work. If you look at the work we're doing to revive intellectual development in the ANC through the Tambo School of Leadership, you can see that that is renewal. So there are quite a lot of things that contribute to the discourse on the renewal of the African National Congress. I've responded to your question, Sam Tanda, about the option of being in the opposition. There was a question from Moloko also about Boy Mamabulo. Well, I suppose citizens and members of the ANC have got an option to exercise their rights in law, for as long as it is done within the ambit of the rule of law in our country. And one of those things that we posit as key conditions for whoever we're going to collaborate with in the government of national unity is the respect for the rule of law. It's one of the non-negotiables. The respect for our constitutional democracy, because we know how difficult it was to get to a point where we have a country that is working, that has got a strong constitution, and where constitutional democracy is hard at work. Part of the outcome of this election is a reflection of the effectiveness of our constitutional architecture. Alliance partners are key to the ANC. The journey that we've traveled with alliance partners comes a long way. And they're part of the consultations that are currently taking place, and they have been consulted. And so we're comfortable that even the way COSATU or the Communist Party or SALCO is quoted outside, we're comfortable about the internal process of consultation that is currently underway. That's all I'm willing to say on this matter. On the matter of Mpumalanga province, this is again still up in the air, given the fact that all of the premier candidates are going to be finalized latest by Monday or thereabout, and we'll have a clear picture on that. I do not wish to get involved in the internal dynamics, because you seem to have more information than I do on this particular matter. We often don't respond on the stuff that's been shared on the side. We normally just respond on matters that are official. I need to just have a quick look at what else. Yeah, will the ANC take stock of the electoral outcome? Or will it be a thing of taking collective responsibility? That must have been from Sunday World. Yeah, collective responsibility is contained in our constitution at all times. But collective responsibility doesn't mean we don't isolate areas for improvement or isolate areas of weakness. So you always have to balance that when you look at the way the ANC conducts its own conversations. There will be a National Executive Committee, not tomorrow's one, because of time constraints, that will do a thorough assessment of the elections, our performance, and everything related to that, that is a decision. It has to happen anyway. JZ, being a disciplined member, and whether he can bring in numbers, should be asked to bring in numbers. Jacob Zuma is currently suspended, and we are allowing the National Disciplinary Committee, and I know the anxiety from members of the media about why is it taking so long. But we do urge you to allow for a process of the conclusion of that. He is a suspended member. So we are not looking for numbers from somebody that is suspended, currently suspended. Unless things pan out differently. But as we said, we had approached the MK party and are awaiting their response. We had to do it as a matter of principle so that no one is excluded, no one is left behind, being the mantra of the ANC. Our campaign slogan says, let's do more together. And we've been magnanimous enough to be able to do something of that nature. Are all political parties going to be, I think that was a question, my sister, considered in the government of national unity? I'm not certain. I mean, we have so many political parties in South Africa. That would be a function of negotiation and also the various contributions and the skill sets that people ought to bring to government to ensure we constitute an executive and the legislative arm that is made up of competent individuals, that is made up of experienced individuals, that more importantly represent the demographics of our beloved country, South Africa. So those are the big principles that I can refer to. And it's not a matter of, it will just be a government of national unity constituted by an army of different parties. It also depends, of course, on the negotiations that are currently underway. I do trust, from Salam Media, did I respond to your question?
Were you ignored or they responded?
I'm asking if I responded to your question.
Not quite clearly.
Please reiterate.
Were you completely ignored by the MK or they responded with no interest?
Oh, okay. I don't think that it's a case of either or. Because when you approach people, they need to consult and they need to come back to you. I can't come to a conclusion that we've been ignored. It would be unfair to do so. Right. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We are adjourned. What about it? Isn't it only correct? Yeah, just reiterate your question. I want it. We have responded to that question by saying that the rule of law is foremost in our country. Even in all these negotiations that we're going to be having with different parties, the rule of law comes first, is sacrosanct. Even in the case of Zizi Kodwa, the rule of law must gain traction. And the step-aside policy of the ANC is going to be kicking in immediately.
Does the remain on the list to Parliament or is automatically removed?
The electoral committee, headed by Halima Mutlante, Comrade Halima Mutlante, will obviously look at these developments and come to a particular conclusion. It is not going to be, it's an untenable situation in any case that he can remain on the list, given the step-aside policy. It's as simple as that.
Understood.
Can I respect the declaration of the new government?